How many 10-year-olds, you know, were dying to go to school every day? And if they had a sick day, screamed and threw tantrums and said, I'm not that sick, I have to go to school.
What river's coming up now? Who remembers? What river?
Think.
No one tell me the river.
But what's the real name?
Mississippi.
There we go. There's the first swimmer swimming down the Mississippi.
That's Kurt.
Swimming down the Mississippi River.
And it was a really long river.
It was a
hot day.
And it seemed forever, right, Bunny?
Yeah.
It's a long, long river.
Yeah, it sure is.
We must remember how children learn rather than how we teach. Through movement, through emotions, through activities, through projects, all the basics fit in. And they're learning without realizing they're learning. Learning is not painful, learning should be joyful.
We were always reading Shakespeare, we were always encouraged to read all types of literature.
Vote for Shaw! Vote for Shaw! Go Shaw!
Children who get early exposure to great art, great music, great literature, don't run away from it ever in their lifetime. It's like a friend.
Almighty Caesar, beware the Ides of March.
Hail Caesar!
Students are turned on by greatness and bored by mediocrity. And so he gave us greatness.
I was in fifth grade in 1959-60. And this was, of course, the end of, you know, that long snooze known as the Eisenhower era. And basically it was, education was pretty standardized. You know, you taught by the book.
Come with me, Jackrabbit. You are too little to run away. I will stay in my nest, said little Jackrabbit.
So when a teacher like Al Cullum came along, who was, a breath of fresh air is a mild way of putting it. It's more like a tornado or a cyclone came along and just proceeded to like blow all the cobwebs off the system.
If you find the success level of each child, there's no problem. And everyone has a success level, whether it's math or science or painting, or being in a play, and you feel good when you're successful.
When I was in Rye, New York, I was the only black in the class, and I often felt less than. But that particular year, I believe that I was able to overcome a great deal. And I felt as though my classmates loved me. I felt as though my teacher loved me.
I think that teacher education on a national level is a cancer of mediocrity. It really is. And that sounds very negative, but it's true. It should be 4 years of self-development, not how you're going to inject facts into people, how you have developed.
I was attracted to teaching the alternative high schools, particularly those that are in the poorest areas of the city. I think Mr. Cullum's techniques are a constant source of inspiration for me.
You all have done excellent research projects on the death penalty.
However, it has to be converted to a new reality.
We'll go back and forth one more.
In the suburbs and private schools, they're being taught critical thinking, they're working with computers, they're being prepared for the information age. Working class kids, kids of color in the inner cities, they're being prepared to flip burgers. The girls are being prepared for motherhood at 16 years old.
As for their race argument,
and whether the bureaucrats in charge of the education system are conscious of that or not, what is being done is perpetuating that system and tracking these kids into those paths of life.
Speak on the juveniles and the death penalty?
If you teach the kids how to think critically, if you personalize instruction, if they learn their skills in the process of doing interesting work, you're going to get squelched. That's threatening to other people who are invested in the current system and fundamentally are not interested in these kids and their education.
Any more reports?
The issue is how many kids will pass such and such test.
All right, thanks you guys.
When it comes down to it, a major battle has to go on in our public school system if we're going to rescue millions of kids from either miseducation or driving them out of school altogether.
Well, you held your ground.
These are wonderful kids, and they deserve much better than they're getting.
I think teaching is pushing them away from you through doors, different doors, not embracing them. When you embrace someone, you're holding them back. Picasso really captured that in his artwork, Mother and Child. The chunky mother, balancing the baby perfectly. She doesn't hold him, it's balanced. He can go anytime he's capable of going, but he's perfectly balanced until he takes the step. Classroom teaching should be there. Find a security spot for them, and then they're ready to go. The gathering of all my former students was a fulfillment of my life, to see them all in their 40s and 50s, and they were the same. We had no difficulty communicating at all. I was very fortunate in those 10 golden years, very fortunate to be part of their lives.
Mr. Cullum is a national treasure. The gift he has to impart is so rare. And the proof is in all the children who he's taught.
Now, functioning as a teacher, I understand how committed Mr. Cullum was to us. He kept fighting to stay in the classroom, and he was there for us.
My friends, it's a tie. 12 for Shaw, 12 for Shakespeare, and 1 for poor Sophocles. Thank you. Class dismissed.
Mr. Cullum attempted to do all he could to go beyond cultures, and that in a real sense, he brought the world into the classroom, because he did so many different things to incorporate teaching and learning.
He just let people open boxes and travel and learn and pursue things.
I feel very fortunate. So many children enter my life, so many. They kept my soul young. It was young, but it stayed young, yes.
Thank you.
I think our trip from sea to shining sea is almost over.
Yeah.
Even though it was a make-believe trip?
Yes.
But make-believe trips are not dangerous, are they?
No.
I mean, I think it's good to make-believe in school. You can make-believe many things. And it was a wonderful trip. I'm willing to take a trip with you anytime.